Welcome to the Peach and Black Podcast, your central place to hear unofficial news, reviews, trivia, and intelligent discussion on all things happening in the Prince world. Featuring the hosts, MC.
You know, it's got all those classic Prince elements.
Captain.
Why wouldn't you just record as much as you could?
Player.
It's just like a storage house of ideas.
Toe Jam.
Either version. I love both versions.
Hello, 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 and welcome back to the Peach and Black podcast. We've got the whole crew here again, once again, for your listening pleasure. In 2017, we're about to go deep once more.
7 inches deep.
There he is. Toe Jam, he beat me to the punch. We've got Toe Jam, we've got Player.
Sugar on a candy cane.
And, of course, we have Captain.
Oh, I can't even say anything. I want to do a quote from a certain track, but there's just too many and I couldn't pick one. We'll just wait till we get
Captain
there.
Right now is tall, stiff and ready, wearing his blue jeans, reading science magazines.
Something you prepared earlier. Beautiful. I love it.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. And, what a vision.
Yeah, yeah. Try and get that out of your mind while you're listening to us talk about this album review. And Rob S. here. It's my pleasure to be back again with the guys and presenting another episode. This is our first show for 2017, Peach and Black Podcast. Ooh, still going strong. And after the incredibly crazy year...
Garbage is the word you're looking for. Incredibly garbage year of 2016.
Yeah, that it was. And it'll be a year none of us will ever forget for obvious reasons. But we're moving on now. We're doing our best to move on in the best possible way. And
but this
that
is the
means,
tribute.
Yeah, that's it. So we're here to talk about...
We're moving on by talking about the past.
And we're going way back.
You've got to go backwards before you can go forwards.
We're starting with an album review for our 2017 kickoff show. And today's album is Vanity 6, the first and only album released by the group Vanity 6, which was a group put together by Prince. And this album came out late in 1982, I want to say August of 1982, and pretty much produced entirely by Prince. You know, it got the typical Prince treatment, you know, composed, arranged, really performed instrumentally anyway by Prince. And then he's got some female vocals over the top
we
of all the
say,
music.
Under the guise of the Star Company.
Oh, Jamie Star.
That's right. Who could that be?
Have you seen those couple of photos that have come out in the last, probably in the last year? There's a few photos of him as Jamie Star, and they're just classic, hilarious photos. There's a couple with Morris Day, and there's just great photos.
I thought they were fake at first. I'm like, that doesn't look like Prince at all. But then you're like,
it's him. They're great photos. I love them.
And it's funny. I don't know whether they've been around before or whether they just came out recently, you know, relatively recently. I certainly hadn't seen them before, so I don't know if they were circulating or not.
If you haven't seen it, we should say the picture's basically like Prince and Morris Day, like on the mixing desk. They've got like cash and cigarettes spread out everywhere. And then there's like a centerfold of Vanity in a penthouse or something. It's hilarious.
Pure purple pimpness, basically. It's fantastic. And that was exactly around the time when, pardon the pun, Prince was putting together the Time Project, his own 1999 funk magnum opus, and this album, Vanity 6. So it was the triple threat year. You had three albums, you had three acts, you had the triple threat tour where all three
artists
came out.
Just like 1998, Duke Khan and Larry Graham.
Just like that one, it.
Oh, yeah, it was a threat, actually. Yeah.
I want to be free. Oh, fantastic. Fantastic times. We'll get to the 1998 era in another episode, I'm sure. Maybe we can talk about some of the live performances that were occurring around that time. But that's for another day, possibly another show. But we'll get into that later. Vanity 6, the album. 8 tracks of music that we're about to go into in our typical Peach and Black fashion where we dissect the songs, the music, the lyrics, and everything else in between. So before we go into track number one, which is Nasty Girl, any other random comments or remarks that anyone has around this era, around what Prince was doing at the time? Okay, Captain, shoot.
I hadn't listened to this album up until about 2 weeks ago. I'd only listened to it probably once or twice in my entire life. I would have listened to it when I first found out about it, which was however many years ago, and then maybe once again at some point, and never bothered to listen to it again. And then about 2 weeks ago, when we're going to review it, I listened to it a lot, and I can't believe I didn't listen to it for so long, because one of the songs on here is now like one of my favorite songs ever. It's just unbelievable.
Actually, it never occurred to me. I'm surprised that this isn't like your number one album. Like, you love all that Japanese like girl pop stuff, and this is like, you know, Prince's equivalent of that stuff.
It's very pop. There's some good stuff on here. We'll get to it.
So the only thing that I've got to add before we go into the song by song reviews is just how prolific he was. And, you know, we've spoken about this in past episodes, and I kind of mentioned it a second ago when I spoke about the triple threat year of 1982, I guess, where you had Prince releasing his own album, the Time album, and then this album. It must be mentioned that this has to be one of the most prolific years, and there are others, but certainly one of the most prolific years in his history, as far as recording music and putting projects together. And, you know, this project was basically a vanity project. Again,
exactly.
Pardon the pun, because it was his version of his alter ego, or the feminine side of his ego, I should say.
Definitely.
The Time was his alter ego, I guess, but to a large degree. But this is quite remarkable that, and at the time, many people may not have known how involved Prince was. You know, you didn't have the internet back in 1982. So I'm sure that people picked up this record and may have had literally no idea that it was a Prince-associated artist project, which is kind of crazy.
Let me just add one thing to what you said there. Yes, it was a very prolific year, but also it's obvious to me, that doesn't mean it's true, but it's obvious to me that this album and the First Time album, as prolific a year as it was and all these albums came out, at some points I can hear he's stretching it pretty thin. There's like the bare hint of a song in some songs. And it's like, oh, I've got to fill an album, so... But you compare that to, like, 1986, another super prolific year, and everything was amazing, and every song was a lot better than some of these.
Yeah, it may not be pound for pound the greatest year in his history, but it's got to be up there. This was at a point in time when he hadn't hit superstardom yet. And now we can go back and look at this record that we're about to talk about in the context of everything we know about him and his life and his musical, you know, adventures. But crucially, much of the context that I'm going to be reviewing these songs in is this is another side of Prince, basically. And I'm sure all of us, you know that and are going to talk about that. But I just thought for anyone who's maybe a little less knowledgeable about the Vanity 6 project, that's a cornerstone. It's not just another album by a girl band. It's basically Prince creating a female version of his, you know, musical signature.
Yeah, this album goes in the official discography for me, along with the Time albums. Well, the first three anyway.
So as remarkable as it is...
I just want to say one more thing before you keep going. I don't know if this is true, but I read a whole bunch of reviews of this album, and I don't know if this is true or not, but it said in his initial deal, which... Initial deal must mean like the, you know, 77, that Prince negotiated with Warner Brothers a clause that allowed him to recruit and produce side projects for Warner Brothers. He was thinking about that stuff when he signed his first contract. Are you kidding me? Again, I don't know if it's true, but if that is just insane.
He would have been what, 19
before
at the time?
He'd even done his first album. He'd probably already planned like the first few. And yeah, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to get girl groups, and I'm going to do all this stuff. That's insane, if that's a true fact.
That is crazy.
It would surprise me, because isn't that part of the reason why he chose Warner Brothers, because they were offering him multiple album contract and this sort of thing?
Yeah, he did get a few offers, but not on the...
I think Warner's had the most freedom or something, or the, like, less constrictions or something in it, yeah.
Yeah, I think the other ones were less interested in him producing himself. Like, they were giving him all this cash and all this stuff and saying, yeah, everything's great with one little caveat. We want, you know, Maurice White.
We're having our producer,
Yeah, I think the rumor or the legend goes that one of the other labels, and I can't remember exactly which one, said, we're going to give you this upfront advance for this many albums, but we want, who's the bass player for Earth, Wind & Fire? Verdeen.
Maurice?
Yeah, Verdeen, yeah.
Yeah, so Verdeen to produce. and he refused. And then Warner Brothers tried the same trick, but obviously Mo Austin got in the way and said, no, you know, you can do it all, once they saw him lay down tracks in the studio.
Morris White himself, I thought.
Yeah, I was thinking Morris White. Oh, who knows?
Nah.
Someone knows.
Anyway. Yeah, we are off topic.
Tommy Vercola or something. I can't remember.
Look, it's a good point that you raised about the fact that side projects were supposedly written into his initial contract. That's crazy if it's true. We should do a bit of digging and find out how accurate
that is. One more thing. I've got more. Like you said, this was released August 82, and this was just 2 weeks before What Time Is It? The first album by The Time came out, and just 2 months before Monster 1999. So that's pretty tricky.
Yeah.
And the vinyl, here's one for you, MC. The vinyl, it had side one and side six on the other side because of Vanity 6. Ha ha!
Very good.
Genius.
Well, shock horror, I don't own this on vinyl format, so I wouldn't have known that.
I'm sure you could scrape up $1,000 to pick up an original copy.
So actually, you know what? Just before we go into track number one, I'm thinking of something else we should probably throw out there to the fans that may not be aware of it. Vanity 6, the name. Everyone knows what the 6 stands for, right?
You're going to get there, are you?
I'm just saying.
Is it boobies?
Well, it certainly ain't testicles. So.
Unless Prince has been hiding a deep, dark secret all those years.
We are back to classic Kitchen Black form. I'm loving every minute of it. Very good. Well, you know what?
Players, Vanity right, six let's pack.
let's not get too off topic. There's so much we could talk about without getting into the music at all. So why don't we just do what we do
originally
best.
Prince wanted to call them the Hookers, so I read.
That's true. That's very true.
Wasn't he also going to call them Vagina Six or something?
That was another option.
Yeah.
Probably a little bit too obvious.
he was going for it. All the great names.
Could have called
then he had pussy control. He had pussy control and he called them Vanity Six.
Technically, if he would have went with that one play, he could have shortened the name to V3 or something. But no, that's probably not.
Track one.
Yeah, we are definitely out of our comfort zone now.